Critical thinking, using frequency distributions to understand data. In statistics, we're often interested in determining whether the data have a normal distribution. The frequencies start low, then increase to one or two high frequencies, and then decrease to a low frequency. The distribution is approximately symmetric. Frequencies preceding the maximum frequency should be roughly a mirror image of those that follow the maximum frequency. These are the two criteria that we're using to determine whether a distribution appears to be normal. For example, does the frequency distribution appear to have a normal distribution using a strict interpretation of the relevant criteria? Remember, the relevant criteria where the frequencies start low, increase to one or two high frequencies, then decrease to a low frequency. The distribution is approximately symmetric. Frequencies preceding the maximum frequency should be roughly a mirror image of those that follow it. In this particular case, notice that we do have a peak. This would be our peak point, but there are not, basically that mirror image, there are not similar data values in the classes below that peak as there are in the classes above. So no, there does not appear to be a normal distribution, and the reason would be that the two criteria are not met. And remember, the criteria are starts low, peaks, and then returns to low. Not symmetric. That would be your explanation. Gaps. The presence of gaps can show that the data are from two or more different populations. However, the converse is not true, because data from different populations do not necessarily result in gaps. Here's an example. The table shown is a frequency distribution of the weights in grams of randomly selected pennies. Notice that we've got a frequency of 18 and 19, so 37 pennies that have a weight between 2.40 and 2.59 inclusive. And then there are no pennies that have the weight in these three classes. But once we get to 2.9, we see that we have 35 pennies that have a weight between 2.90 and 3.19 grams inclusive. So what could be a possible reason that there would be such a gap in the data? Well, examination of the frequencies reveals that large gap is between the lightest pennies and the heaviest pennies. It may suggest that we have two different populations. Maybe pennies made before 1983 are 9%, 95% copper and 5% zinc, as compared to pennies made after 1983, which has a different composition of elements. So that could possibly be the reason that there are gaps, is that there are heavier pennies in the later years since the zinc content was much higher than in previous years. Combining two or more relative frequency distributions into one table makes comparisons of data much easier, just like we found with the cigarette example that we did. Here's comparing McDonald's and Dunkin' Donuts. The table shows the relative frequency distribution for the drive-through lunch service times in seconds for McDonald's and Dunkin' Donuts. Now, we've used McDonald's several times, but notice that we've now incorporated Dunkin' Donuts. And the wait time in the drive-through for lunch service times is for McDonald's shown here and for Dunkin' Donuts shown here. Because of the dramatic differences in their menus, we might expect the service times to be very different. But by comparing the relative frequencies, we see that there are major differences. The Dunkin' Donuts service times appear to be lower than those at McDonald's.